Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to join the network. Please stand by.
I want to welcome all of you to the Black Box Theater.
Why don't you use the tall man's mic?
The tall man's
mic.
Okay. There you go. All right. I want to make a couple of quick announcements, some changes in the program, just a couple of brief changes in the program, and a few other items very quickly. First of all, in your program, it indicates that the usher is Amy Heiser. She worked last night. Tonight's usher is Cindy Zortman. We also have an additional actress that joined us after the program was printed, and she is a WIT student, and her name is Tanya Whaler. So she is going to join us in both of tonight's programs. What I want to mention also are some protocol. With live performances here in the Black Box, we have a protocol that if you have to get up and leave during a performance, when you come back in, the usher will seat you in some cheap seats over on the side.
You're at an institution of higher learning and you're encouraging people to use cheat sheets. That's just fine.
Yeah, well, here's the reason.
Can you, like, make this quick?
Yes.
All right.
What we want to do is make sure that there's no interruptions and distractions with the players as well as the audience. The usher will then escort you to your seat during appropriate time or break in the show. Another thing, before we take you back to 1938, please, if you have a cell phone, and if it's a camera phone, fine, you can take pictures. Make sure, however, all cell phone ringers are off. So you may want to do that now if you haven't. Oh, ding, 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 ding. Okay. And we're going to have a 15-minute intermission. There's going to be some great snacks for you.
Did you mention the T-shirts?
No, I didn't.
There's some T-shirts over there, and they're only $10. And you can make great Christmas gifts, stocking stuffers, and they'll help us to have a Christmas. Otherwise, I don't know what we're going to do.
Okay, and one final thing. We do have an applause light, but please feel totally free to be spontaneous, to laugh if there's something funny, to clap, to do whatever, to cry. Some of you may cry. Because even in the days of early radio, the in-studio audience participated. And even though we're recording this and it's going to be rebroadcast on radio, two stations in Sioux City, it enhances it to hear the reaction of the audience. So feel unintimidated.
Yes, and just don't throw anything. And just so you know, because it's no fun to have to duck, you know, especially with the lights. It's hard to see that stuff coming at you, and I know because it wouldn't be the first time. Just so you know, thanks for that, by the way. I'll pay you later. That was a $10 laugh right there. These shows will be broadcast on later December. Can't get any later. It's November 30th. But in December, these shows will be broadcast on KSCJ AM. And KWIT-FM. What was that? What's going on back there, Brian? Our sound effects man is chomping at the bit. Obviously, it's time to get the show on the road, ladies and gentlemen. So, without further ado, the Great Plains Radio Theater is on the air.
Halo, everybody, halo. Halo is the shampoo that glorifies your hair. So, halo, everybody, halo.
Use Halo Shampoo if you want naturally bright and beautiful hair. Remember, even finer soaps and soap shampoos hide the natural luster of your hair with dulling soap film. But Halo contains no soaps, therefore it cannot leave dulling soap film. The first time you use Halo, your hair glistens in all its natural brilliance. The natural color and luster shines like sunshine through a clear window pane. So remember to use Halo this Christmas and look your best at any holiday gathering among family and friends. Say hello to Halo and goodbye to dulling soap film. Use Halo on your children's hair, too. Get Halo shampoo at any cosmetic counter. Remember, Halo glorifies your hair.
So Halo, everybody, Halo. Halo shampoo, Halo.
Radio Theater Project presents A Christmas Carol. This radio adaptation of Charles Dickens' classic novel was originally performed by Orson Welles and the Mercury Players on Christmas Eve, 1939, over the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Marley was dead to begin with. There's no doubt whatever about that. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. Scrooge signed it, and Scrooge's name was good upon change for anything he chose to put his hand to. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. Scrooge knew he was dead? Of course he did. Scrooge and Marley were partners for I don't know how many years. But he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone with Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. And, once upon a time, of all the good days in the year, on Christmas Eve.
Don't rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior.
Old Scrooge sat busy in his counting house. A grim, cheerless place, if ever there was one. The door of Scrooge's counting house was open that he might keep his eye upon his clerk, Bob Cratchit, who in his cold and dismal little cell beyond worked at his ledgers.
19, 20, 21, 22, remember Christ our Savior. 23, 26, 29, 9 carry 2, how when we have gone astray. 17, 13, 17, 7.
Bob Cratchit!
Yes, Mr. Scrooge?
Stop that infernal caterwauling!
Yes, sir. 9, 15, 17.
Singing their idiotic Christmas carols at my very door.
4.
Go on, get away from my door! Go somewhere else and bellow your blasted carols, or I'll give you what for.
Why, Governor? It's an old custom at Christmas time, you know.
Yes, and I don't want any of your old customs. Take your fellow fools and go away. Christmas, bleh.
Right, sir. Merry Christmas anyway, sir.
Now, you get that letter from Higgins and Blackthorne, Cratchit, and then I want you to finish posting this ledger. And after that, you can pop over to Partigill's and tell Ephraim Partigill you've come after the 17 shillings and sixpence he's owed me since Michaelmas. And tell him I shall have a constable over there if he doesn't pay up at once.
Mr. Partigill's wife has been ill, sir.
What do I care about his wife? I want my 17 and 6.
Well, I just thought it being Christmas, sir.
Christmas? Christmas. You mention that word to me once more, Bob Cratchit, and I'll...
A Merry Christmas, Uncle. A Merry Christmas, Bob.
A Merry Christmas, Mr. Fred.
God save you, Uncle.
Bah, humbug.
Christmas a humbug, Uncle. Now, I'm sure you don't mean that.
I mean just that. Exactly that. Merry Christmas. What right have you to be merry? What reason have you? You're poor enough.
Well, what right have you to be dismal about Christmas, Uncle? You're certainly rich enough.
Bah.
Now, don't be cross, Uncle.
Well, what else can I be when I live in such a world of fools? What's Christmas to you but a time for paying bills without money? Merry Christmas. A time for finding yourself a year older and not an hour richer. If I could work my will, every idiot who goes about with Merry Christmas on his lips would be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart. He should.
Uncle!
Now, nephew, keep Christmas in your own way and let me keep it in mine.
Keep it? But you don't keep it, Uncle.
Well, let me leave it alone then. What do you want? A Christmas gift, I've no doubt?
I came to wish you a Merry Christmas, Uncle.
A Merry Christmas. Much good may Christmas do you. Much good it ever has done you.
There are many things from which I derive good by which I have not profited materially, I dare say, Uncle. Christmas among the rest. But I have always thought of Christmas time as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable, pleasant time. And therefore, Uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe it has done me good and will do me good. And I say, God bless it.
God bless Christmas!
Let me hear another sound out of you there, Bob Cratchit. And you'll keep your Christmas by losing your situation. And as to you, nephew, I wonder you don't go into Parliament. You talk enough nonsense.
Oh, don't be angry, Uncle. I want nothing from you. I ask nothing of you. Why can't we be friends?
Good afternoon.
I'm sorry you feel that way. Well, I tried. A Merry Christmas to you, Uncle.
Good afternoon.
And a Happy New Year, too.
Bah, humbug.
And a Merry Christmas to you, Bob, and the missus, and the Tiny Tim.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Fred. Same to you. A good day, sir.
Good day, Bob.
Nonsense, twaddle, flummery. Talking of Christmas and not 2 sixpences to jingle together in his trousers pocket. Hey! Hey! You there, Bob Cratchit! Come here! What are you doing there?
Well, I'm only putting a little bit more coal in the fire, Mr. Scrooge. See, it's cold in here.
You put that coal back into the scuttle. A fire? A fire indeed. I can tell you, if you use coal at that rate, you and I will soon be parting company, Bob Cratchit. You understand that? There's many a young fella'd like your situation, you know?
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. My fingers were getting a little stiff with the cold.
Then put on your mittens. There's someone at the door. Go on, see who it is.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
This is the firm of Scrooge and Marley.
Yes, sir.
I should like to see the head of the firm, if I may.
Oh, very good, sir.
What is it?
A gentleman to see you, Mr. Scrooge.
Have I the pleasure of addressing Mr. Scrooge or Mr. Marley?
Marley's been dead these 7 years tonight. I'm Scrooge.
Well now, Mr. Scrooge, at this season of the year, it's only fitting that we who are more fortunate should raise a fund to buy the poor some meat, drink, and means of warmth. You may not believe it, sir, but many thousands are now in want of common necessities. And hundreds of thousands are in want of the simplest comforts.
Are there no prisons?
Well, yes, there are plenty of prisons, sir.
And the workhouses. They're still in operation, I trust.
I wish I could say they are not, but yes, they are, sir.
The treadmill and the poor law are in full vigor, then?
Both very busy.
Ah, I'm glad to hear that. I was afraid, from what you said at first, that something had occurred to stop them in their useful course.
No, sir. All these institutions that you mention are flourishing, but it's nevertheless true that some additional provision for the poor and the destitute must be made. A few of us, upon change, are endeavoring to raise a fund, you see. And, shall I put you down for...
Nothing.
Oh, I see. You wish to be anonymous, then.
I wish to be left alone. I don't make merry myself at Christmas time, and I can't afford to help make a lot of idle people merry. I help to support the establishments that take care of the poor. They cost enough. Let those who are badly off go there.
Many can't go there, sir, and many would rather die.
Then my advice to them is to do so, and decrease the surplus population. Besides, I've only your word for it that all this is so.
That's the truth, Mr. Scrooge.
Well, so be it then. It's not my business. It's enough for a man to understand his own business and not to interfere with other people's. Mine occupies me constantly. Good afternoon, sir.
I quite understand, Mr. Scrooge.
Good afternoon.
Cratchit, show this gentleman the door.
Yes, sir. This way, sir, please. Sir, I couldn't help but overhear. I should like to contribute a tuppence.
Cratchit!
Yes, sir. It isn't much, but it's all I can afford. But there are others in worse situation than I.
You're a very generous fellow. I wish I might say so of your employer.
Cratchit!
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Cratchit.
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas! Yes, sir.
Close the door.
Yes, sir. $24.31. 1, carry the 3. A new scarlet tippet for Tiny Tim. A comb for Martha. 33.3. And carry the 3. A hair ribbon for Belinda. 4, 7, 12, 15.
Cratchit! It!
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, it's too late to have you go to Particles. He'll be all closed up for Christmas like these other fools. We may as well close up the place now.
Yes, sir. It is getting a little dark. Hard to see the figures.
I suppose you'll want the entire day tomorrow.
Well, if it's quite convenient, sir.
It's not convenient. And it's not fair either. But I suppose I can't do anything about it. If I was to stop half a crown of your wages, you'd think yourself very ill-used, I'll be bound.
Well, sir, I
don't... Yes, but don't think me ill-used when I pay a day's wages for no work.
Well, it's only once a year, sir.
Once a year. Once a year, indeed. A fine excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December. But I suppose there's no good talking. You must have the whole day. Well, see that you're here all the earlier the next morning. You understand?
Oh, I will, sir. I will indeed. Good night, sir, and Merry Christmas.
Bah.
Merry Christmas.
Bah!
The office was closed in a twinkling, and Bob Cratchit, with the long ends of his white comforter dangling below his waist, for he boasted no great coat, went down a slide on Cornhill 20 times in honor of it being Christmas Eve. And then he ran home to Camden Town as hard as he could pelt to play with his family at Blindman's Bluff. Scrooge, on the other hand, took his melancholy dinner in his usual melancholy tavern, having read all the newspapers and spent the rest of the evening with his banker's book, went to his dismal house. Darkness is cheap, and Scrooge liked it. The yard was so dark that even Scrooge, who knew its every stone, had to grope with his hands through the fog and the frost to find the door. Scrooge walked through his rooms to see all was right. Sitting room, bedroom, lumber room, all as they should be. Nobody under the table. No one under the sofa. No one under the bed or in the closet. Close the door. He locked himself in. He double-locked himself in and took off his cravat, put on his dressing gown and slippers and his nightcap, and sat down before the fire to take his gruel.
Marley? Marley? Marley! I could have sworn I saw old... Humbug. Marley's been dead these 7 years. Humbug. All humbug. What I need is a good night's sleep. What? What's that? Someone's in the wine cellar. But the door's locked and double locked. Something's coming. Something's coming closer, outside my door. I won't believe it. It's humbug still.
Ebenezer Scrooge. Ebenezer Scrooge.
I want much of you, Ebenezer.
Who are you?
Ask me who I was.
Oh, you're very particular for a ghost. All right then, who were you?
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
Jacob Marley? But you're dead. You died 7 years ago.
7 years ago this very night.
You are a ghost then.
What's wrong, Ebenezer? Don't you believe in me?
I do not.
You doubt your senses, Ebenezer?
Yes. Yes. Because a little thing affects them. A slight disorder of the stomach makes them cheat. You can't be a ghost. You may be an undigested bit of beef, or a blot of mustard, or a crumb of cheese, a fragment of an underdone potato. There may be more gravy than grave about you, whatever you are. Ha, humbug. I tell ya, humbug! I do believe in you. You are a ghost, Jacob.
Thank you.
But why? Why do you walk the earth, Jacob? Why do you come to me?
It is required of every man that the spirit within him should walk abroad among his fellow men and travel far and wide to witness what it cannot share, but might have shared on earth and turn to happiness.
But tell me, Jacob, what is that chain you wear around you?
I wear the chain I forged in life. I made it link by link and yard by yard, by my own free will. Is its pattern strange to you, Ebenezer?
Cash boxes and keys and padlocks? Ledgers and purses?
Yours was as heavy and as long as this. 7 years ago. You have labored on it since, Ebenezer.
Oh, Jacob. Speak comfort to me, Jacob.
Comfort I have none to give. I cannot rest. I cannot stay. I cannot linger. Weary journeys lie before me.
You travel fast?
Yes, Ebenezer. On the wings of the wind.
7 years dead and traveling all the time.
7 years, Ebenezer. 7 years of remorse. Ebenezer, do you know that no space of regret can make amends for one life's opportunities misused?
But you were always a good man of business, Jacob.
Business? Mankind was my business. Charity, mercy, benevolence, they were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business.
Jacob, don't take on so, Jacob.
Listen to me, Ebenezer.
I'll listen to you. Jacob, go on, Jacob. Now, speak to me, but don't be so flowery.
Ebenezer, I'm here to warn you that you may still have a chance of escaping my fate. Do you hear that, Ebenezer?
Yes, Jacob. Yes. You always were a good friend to me, Jacob. Thank you, Jacob. But go on. How shall I escape? Oh, I'm afraid, Jacob.
You will be haunted by three spirits.
Is that the only chance and hope, Jacob.
It is your only chance and hope.
Well, then, I think I'd rather not.
Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow when the bell tolls one.
Couldn't I take them all at once and have it over, Jacob?
Ebenezer, look that for your own sake. You remember what has passed between us. Remember, when the bell tolls one, look for the first spirit.
Marley! Jacob Marley!
Scrooge awoke. He was lying in his bed, fully dressed. Suddenly, the curtains of his bed were drawn aside, and Scrooge found himself face to face with the unearthly visitor who drew them. As close to it as I am now to you, and I'm standing in the spirit at your elbow. It was a strange figure, like a child, yet not so much like a child as like an old man. Its hair, which hung about its neck and drawn down its back, was white as if with age. And yet the face had not a wrinkle, and the tenderest bloom was on the skin. The arms were long and muscular, the hands the same, as if its hold were of uncommon strength.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Who's that?
Ebenezer Scrooge, I have come for you.
You? Are you the spirit, sir, whose coming was foretold to me?
I am that spirit.
Who are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
Long past?
No. Your past.
But, what do you want of me? What brings you here to haunt me?
Your welfare. Ebenezer Scrooge, rise and walk with me!
Oh, no. Not out of the window. I can't do that. I'll fall down. I'm not a spirit. I'm mortal, and I'll fall.
Bear but a touch of my hand upon your heart, and you shall be upheld in more than this. Come, follow me.
Where are we? What's become of the city? And there's snow upon the ground. Where are we?
These are the shadows of the things that have been. You recognize this countryside?
Oh, why, I know every inch of it, every rock, every tree.
And that bleak building over there.
Ah, that building? I was a boy there. Yes, I went to school in that horrible place.
Do you recollect that path?
I could walk it blindfolded.
Strange, you should have forgotten it so many years. Come, let us go closer. Look through that window into that cold, barren room. What do you see, Ebenezer Scrooge?
I see a boy.
A solitary child, neglected by his family. Alone.
Yes, I see. I know that boy.
Oh, I was so lonely. Poor boy.
Your lip is trembling, Scrooge. And what is that on your cheek?
Why, it's nothing. Nothing at all. I wish I... Oh, it's too late now.
What's the matter?
Nothing. Nothing. The waves came to my door singing Christmas carols last night, and there was a boy like that among them. A poor, pale, thin little boy in a ragged coat. I should like to have given him something. That's all.
Is that all? Come, Ebenezer Scrooge, let us see another Christmas. Do you know this place, Ebenezer Scrooge?
Know it? Know it? Why, this is the counting house where I was apprenticed. It's my old master, bless his heart, old Fezziwig. My master, alive again, and hosting one of his Christmas parties. Listen to him. Ah, there's Dickie Wilkins. Ah, poor Dick. Dear, dear, dear. Yes, and look, why, there's Mrs. Fezziwig herself. Looking younger than any of them, and the tables all loaded with roasts and cider, mince pie and beer. Oh, what a lovely time we used to have.
That carefree young man with the light heart and the gay smile. Do you recognize him?
Yes, yes. Merciful heaven, yes. How happy I was then.
A small matter for old Fezziwig to make those silly folks so full of joy.
Small matter? Small indeed.
Isn't it? He has spent only a few pounds of your mortal money. Is that so much that he deserves praise?
It's not that. It's not that, Spirit. Old Fezziwig has the power to make us happy or unhappy, to make our service light or heavy. His power lies in words and looks and in things so tiny that it's impossible to count them up. The happiness he gives is quite as great as if it cost a...
What's the matter?
Oh, nothing. Nothing at all, Spirit.
Something, I think?
No, no.
Speak!
Well, only it's just that I should like to be able to say a word or two to my clerk, Bob Cratchit, that's all.
My time grows short, and we have yet another journey to make.
Where now?
Come! This is our last visit to the past, Ebenezer, here in this little room with the fair young girl by your side. Do you recognize yourself, Ebenezer?
No, oh, no, 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 spare me this.
You're older now, a man in the prime of life. Your face has begun to wear the signs of care and avarice. Your eyes are greedy, the eager, restless eyes of a miser.
No, no, please.
She knows it too, that girl by your side. No. There are tears in her eyes.
It matters little to you, very little. I know that.
Belle, have I changed toward you?
When we were engaged, we were both poor.
Was it better then? Better to be poor?
Better, at least, to be happy. You're changed. You were another man then.
I was a boy. You blame me because I've grown wiser. Have I ever tried to break our engagement?
In words? No, never.
In what then?
In a changed nature. In an altered spirit. in everything that made my love of any value in your sight. So I release you from your promise.
Belle!
Oh, at first it may cause you pain to lose me. A very brief pain. But soon it will be dim, like a half-remembered dream. An unprofitable dream. And you will be glad to be awake from such a dream. May you be happy in the life you have chosen, Ebenezer, for the love of him you once were.
That's enough. Show me no more. Take me home.
These were the shadows of the things that have been. That they are what they are. Do not blame me.
No. No more.
One shadow more. Come. Do you see this man, Ebenezer Scrooge? This man might have been you, and the woman beside him, your wife, and that girl might have been your daughter, Ebenezer Scrooge. She might have called you father. She might have been a springtime in the haggard winter of your life.
Spirit, let me go. Show me no more.
Listen now while they speak, Ebenezer. Oh.
I say, Belle, I saw an old friend of yours today.
Who was it?
Guess.
How can I? It. Oh, I know, Mr. Scrooge.
Mr. Scrooge it was. I passed his office window. It wasn't shuttered. And there was a candle inside, so I couldn't help seeing him. His partner, Marley, lies at the point of death, I hear. And there Scrooge sat, all alone. Quite alone in the world, I do believe.
Spirit! Spirit! I can't bear any more! Leave me! Haunt me no more! Take me back! Take me back!
On the stroke of one, Scrooge awakened suddenly and sat bolt upright in his bed. He remembered the words of Marley's ghost and wondered from which direction the second specter would appear. At that moment, nothing between a baby and a rhinoceros would have astonished him very much. Now, being prepared for almost anything, he was not by any means prepared for nothing, and consequently, when no shape appeared, he was taken to a violent fit of trembling. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, a quarter of an hour went by, yet nothing came. Then, as he sat in his bed, he became aware gradually of a great blaze of ruddy light which seemed to shine upon him from the adjoining room. He got up softly and shuffled in his slippers to the door. It was his own sitting room, no doubt about that. But it had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and the ceiling were hung with living green, that it looked like a perfect grove, from every part of which bright gleaming berries glistened, and such a mighty blaze went roaring up the chimney as had ever been known in Scrooge's time, or for many and many a winter season gone. Heaped up on the floor, to whom a kind of throne, were turkeys, geese, game, poultry, great joints of meat, suckling pigs, long wreaths of sausages, mince pies, plum puddings, barrels of oysters, red hot chestnuts, and seething bowls of punch that made the chamber dim with their delicious steam. In easy state upon his couch, there sat a jolly giant, glorious to see, who bore a glowing torch, in shape not unlike Plenty's horn, and held it up, high up, to shed its light on Scrooge.
as he came peeping round the door.
Come in, Ebenezer Scrooge, and know me better, man.
Who? Who?
I am the ghost of Christmas present. Look upon me. You've never seen the like of me before.
You're different from the other spirit. You're tall, almost a giant. And that great torch you carry...
Its light pours into the homes of rich and poor alike.
Spirit, take me where you will. Last time I went against my will and learned a lesson which is working now. If you have anything to teach me, let me profit by it.
Touch my robe, Ebenezer Scrooge. Touch my robe.
Where have you brought me, spirit?
A humble dwelling in a humble street.
It's humble enough.
Yet there is happiness there.
Who are these people? And who's that woman and the children?
These are the family of your clerk, Bob Cratchit. His wife dressed in a twice-turned gown, but brave in ribbons, laying the table for their Christmas dinner. And there, assisting her, is her daughter, Belinda. And the young man with the fork and the stuffing, that's Master Peter Cratchit, and the two little Cratchits. Listen, Scrooge.
Here's Martha, Mother!
Ah, why, bless your heart alive, Martha, my dear. Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas, Mother.
How late you are, my dear.
Oh, we'd a deal of work to finish up last night, and we had to clear away this morning.
Well, never mind, so long as you're here now. Sit ye down by the fire and have a warm. Lord bless ye.
Where's Father?
He's been to church with Tiny Tim. They'll be along directly.
How is Tiny Tim, Mother? Any better at all?
Sometimes I think he is, and sometimes I think... Dear God, if anything should happen to Tiny Tim...
Mother, you mustn't even think of such a thing.
There's Tiny Tim.
Merry Christmas, everyone. Martha, welcome, my dear.
Merry Christmas, Father. Oh, and Tim.
Merry Christmas, Martha.
Oh, Tim, you darling. Oh, Father, I'm so glad to be home.
And we're so glad to have you, Martha.
And how did little Tim behave in church, Bob?
Oh, as good as gold and better.
I like church, Mother. Oh, they sang the nicest songs. I hope people saw me there.
Saw you there? And why, Tim?
Well, don't you see? Because I'm lame. If they saw my crutch, it might be pleasant for them to remember. On Christmas, who it was made lame beggars walk and blind men see.
Oh, bless you, my son.
All mother? Right.
Oh, no, Mother.
Yes, children, we're all ready. Come, take your places now. And Bob, wait your turn.
Oh.
There's plenty. Stuffing and dressing and plum pudding for all of you. Martha, you take care of Tiny Tim.
Yes, Mother.
You see that he eats plenty. He must get tall and well. Now sit down, everyone.
And now, my dears, shall we say grace?
Spirit, tell me if Tiny Tim will live.
I see a vacant seat in the poor chimney corner, and a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved.
Oh, no, 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 kind spirit. Say he'll be spared. Say he'll live.
If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, Ebenezer, the child will die.
Amen.
Amen.
And now, my dears, with such a dinner, a toast. A Merry Christmas to us all, and God bless us.
Amen.
God bless us, everyone.
And now, to Mr. Scrooge.
What?
I give you a toast to Mr. Scrooge, the founder of the feast.
The founder of the feast, indeed. Who pays you all of 15 shillings a week? I wish I had him here. I'd give him a piece of my mind to feast on, and I hope he'd have a good appetite for it.
Oh, my dear, the children, Christmas Day.
Well, it should be Christmas Day, I'm sure, on which one drinks to the health of such an odious, stingy, unfeeling man as Mr. Scrooge. You know he is, Bob. Nobody knows it better than you, poor fellow.
My dear, Christmas Day.
Well, I'll drink to his health for your sake and the day's, not for his. Long life to him. A Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. He'll be very merry and very happy, I have no doubt.
And I say, God bless him too, Mother, and everyone.
There was nothing of high mark in all this. They were not a handsome family, these Cratchits. They were not well dressed. Their shoes were far from being waterproof. Their clothes were scanty and had known very likely the insides of a pawnbroker's. But they were happy, grateful, pleased with one another, and contented with the time when at last they faded. Scrooge had his eye upon them, and especially on Tiny Tim until the last. Many calls Scrooge made that night with the ghost of Christmas present. Down among the miners they went to labor in the bowels of the earth, and out to sea among the sailors as they watch dark, ghostly figures in their several stations. Much they saw and far they went, and many places they visited, but always with a happy end. The spirits stood beside sick beds, and they were cheerful on foreign lands, and they were close at home by poverty, and it was rich in almshouse, hospital, and jail, where vain men, in his little brief authority, had not made fast the door and barred the spirit out. The spirit left his blessing. It was a long night, if it was only a night. And it was strange, too, that while in his outward form, the ghost grew older, clearly older.
My life upon this globe is very brief, Ebenezer. It ends tonight.
Tonight?
Tonight at midnight. Hark, the hour has come.
Oh, no, no, not yet. Not yet. There are still things that I wish to learn.
These you will learn from still another spirit. Still another spirit, Ebenezer.
Scrooge looked about him for the ghost. It had vanished. And he found himself once more in his bed, in his dressing gown, and his nightcap on his head. He had heard the clock strike, and then he remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting up his eyes, beheld the third spirit. A solemn phantom, shrouded in black, draped and hooded, coming towards him, slowly and silently, like a mist along the ground.
I know you. You are the ghost of Christmas yet to come. You'll show me the shadows of things that have not happened, but will happen in the time before us. Answer me, spirit, ghost of the future. I fear you more than any specter I've seen, yet I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to live, to be another man from what I was. Lead on. Lead on. The night's waning fast and time's precious. Spirit, why have you brought me here again? Here to Bob Cratchit's home. But it's not the same. What? Oh, why is it so quiet? So very quiet here.
Mother, mother, please.
Oh, my son. My little son, Tiny Tim. I loved him so.
Oh, mother, dear, you mustn't. It's almost time for Father to be home. Don't let him see you crying.
Yes. Yes, Martha.
He's late tonight.
He walks slower than he used to, and yet I've known him to walk very fast indeed with Tiny Tim on his shoulder.
So have I, Mother.
But he was light to carry, and his father loved him so that it was no trouble. No trouble. Bob!
Good evening, my dear.
You're late, Bob.
Yes, I'm sorry, my dear. I went to the churchyard today. I wish you could have gone with me. It would have done your heart good to see how sweet and green a place it is. But you'll see it often enough. I promised him. Yes, I promised Tiny Tim we would walk there on a Sunday.
Father, dear,
it's God's will, Bob.
I'm trying to understand it, my dear. Oh, my son. My little son, Tiny Tim. And I loved him so.
Oh, that's cruel. Cruel spirit, can't you give me one ray of hope that I may change all that? That Tiny Tim may live. Where are you taking me now? Where are you taking me? Here? On a common street, spirit. What is there for me to learn here? Who are these men?
I don't know much about it. Either way, I only know he's dead.
When did he die, then?
Last night, I believe.
It's likely to be a very cheap funeral, for upon my life, I don't know anybody to go to it. Suppose we made up a party to volunteer.
I don't mind going. If a lunch is provided.
You know, come to think of it, I bet I was his best friend.
What?
We used to nod to each other when we met in the street.
Spirit, help me. Who is this man that died? Is there no one to mourn the poor creature? No one to follow him to the grave? Perhaps they'll give him a green grave, at least, like poor Tiny Tim, perhaps. Spirit, where are we now? Oh, merciful heaven, a churchyard overrun by grass and weeds, choked with too much burying, desolate, lonely, crumbling gravestones. Spirit! Before I draw nearer to that gravestone, answer me one question. Are these shadows of things that will be, or are they shadows of things that may be only? Huh? Will you not speak to me, spirit? What is that grave to which you point? Now I see it. There's a writing on that stone. The gravestone's engraving reads, Ebenezer Scrooge! Ebenezer Scrooge! Oh, no, no, spirit! No, 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 hear me! I'm not the man I was. Why show me this if I'm past all hope? Tell me that I can change these dreadful shadows you've shown me by an altered life. I'll honor Christmas in my heart. I'll try. I'll keep it all the year. I'll live in the past and the present and the future, and I'll not shut out the lessons that they teach. Tell me, Spirit,
Oh, go on, tell me. Tell me that I can sponge away the writing on that stone. That I can take away the name on that stone, Spirit, I beg you. Spirit, I beg you. Spirit, I promise on my knees, I promise, why, what's this? It's my own drape. Oh, I'm home, in my own bed. In my own room. And the sun. Why, the sun's shining. It's clear. It's bright. No fog. What a beautiful day. Oh, glorious. Glorious. Hey, boy. Oh, boy.
Yes, sir?
What day is it today, my fine fellow?
What's that, sir?
Today. What day is it?
Today? Why, it's Christmas Day.
Aha! Christmas Day! Then I haven't missed it! The spirits have done it all in one night! All in one night! Heaven be praised!
How's that, sir?
Listen, my lad. You know where the poulterer is in the next street?
I should say I do.
Ha! An intelligent boy. A remarkable boy. Tell me, do you know if they sold the prize turkey that was hanging in the window?
As big as mine.
What a delightful boy. It's a pleasure to talk to ye. Yes, my buck.
It's hanging there now, sir.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Go down, will ye? And tell him to send it to Bob Cratchit and his family on Broad Street. And mind ye, they're not to know who paid for it. Go along. Hurry. Hurry, my lad. Here, wait a minute. Here's half a crown for your trouble.
What? Yes, sir. I mean, yes, sir. And a Merry Christmas, sir.
And a Merry Christmas to you, my boy. I don't know what to do. I'm as light as a feather, as happy as an angel. I'm as merry as a schoolboy. Merry Christmas. A Merry Christmas to everybody. A Happy New Year to all the world. Woohoo! Hello! My dear sir, how do you do?
I beg your pardon.
Well, you, sir, aren't you the gentleman who came to my office in regard to that charity?
Why, yes, sir.
A Merry Christmas to you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Allow me to ask your pardon, sir. And will you have the goodness to accept, I prefer to whisper this, 1,000...
What? Lord bless me, my dear. Mr. Scrooge, are you serious?
If you please. Now, not a farthing less. A great many back payments are included in it. I assure you, will you do me that favor?
Well, my dear sir, I don't know what to say to such a...
Now, don't say anything, please. Come and see me, will you? Will you come and see me?
I will. I will indeed.
Thank ye. I'm much obliged to you. I thank you 50 times. Bless you. Merry Christmas.
Next morning, Scrooge was early to his office. He went there for a reason. If he had only could get there first and catch Bob Cratchit coming late, that was the thing he had his heart set upon. And he did it. Yes, he did. The clock struck 9. No Bob. A quarter past. No Bob. Scrooge sat with his door wide open that he might see him come in. At last he came. His hat was off before he opened the door, his comforter too. He was on a stool in a jiffy, driving away with his pen, as if he were trying to overtake 9 o'clock.
15 and 21, 6 carry the 1, 24 and carry the 2, 31 and 8 and 9.
Hello, you Cratchit.
Yes, sir.
Step this way, Cratchit, if you please. Cratchit, what do you mean by coming in at this time of day?
Why, Well, I'm very sorry, sir. I'm behind my time.
You are. Yes, yes, I think you are.
Oh, it's only once a year, Mr. Scrooge. It shall not be repeated. I was making rather merry yesterday, sir.
I'll tell you what, my friend. I'll not stand this sort of thing any longer. And therefore, Bob Cratchit, I am about to raise your salary.
Mr. Scrooge? Are you quite yourself, sir?
No. No, thank heaven. I'm not quite myself. Merry Christmas, Bob. Merry Christmas, my good fellow. A merrier Christmas than I've given you in many a year. I shall raise your salary, and we'll see what we can do for Tiny Tim and the rest of your family. We'll discuss it this very afternoon over a Christmas bowl of smoking bishop. Oh, and Bob, make up the fire, will you? Make it up and buy another coal scuttle before you dot another I, Bob Cratchit.
Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all and infinitely more. To Tiny Tim, who did not die, he was a second father. He became as good a friend, as good a master, and as good a man as the good old city knew, or any other good old city, town, or borough. In the good old world. Some people laughed to see the alteration in him, but he let them laugh, and little heeded them. In his own heart, he laughed. That was quite enough for him. He had no further intercourse with spirits, but lived upon the total abstinence principle ever afterwards. And it was said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well, if any man alive possessed the knowledge. May that truly be said of us, of all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed,
God bless us, everyone.
You've just heard the Great Plains Radio Theater Project, presentation of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Our cast included Chris Gall, who served as the narrator and also played the part of Marley. The part of Scrooge was played by Paul Guggenheimer, who also directed the program. The part of Bob Cratchit was played by Michael Scaff, with Karen Sawensky as Mrs. Cratchit, Ben Vipond as Tiny Tim, Megan Vipond as Martha the Child and the Errand Boy, Levi Davis as the Ghost of Christmas Past, Chad Gall as the Ghost of Christmas Present, Kathy Fouch as Belle and the First Girl, Nolly Vereen as Belle's Husband and the Gentleman, Tim Black as Fred and the Second Man, Mick Vipond as the First Man, and Tanya Whaler as the Second Girl. The acoustical sound effects were supplied by Ralph Swain. The Western Iowa Tech Choir was directed by Gene Busker, and our sound effects technician was Brian Ross. My name is Tom Jones. Thank you for listening.
Prowl leaves hair more, more, more radiant. Prowl leaves hair more radiant. And cream or soap shampoo. Does that mean Prel leaves hair more radiant than cream or soap shampoos in hard water?
Yes, even in hardest water, tests prove that Prel leaves hair more radiant than cream or soap shampoos. Procter & Gamble's Prel is different. Not an ordinary cream, not a liquid. Prel is concentrated shampoo in a tube. Emerald clear for extra radiance.
Radiant hair is beautiful hair.
So try Prel today.
Prel leaves hair more, more, more radiant. Prel leaves hair more radiant than cream or soap shampoo.
This is GPR, the Great Plains Radio Theater Network. And we're off. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You've been a wonderful audience. I hope you'll stay for the second show. We're going to take a 15-minute intermission. Lots of refreshments over there along that table. T-shirts over there. Refreshments are free. The T-shirts a little more. Which means that what you save over there, you can spend over there. We'll see you shortly. Thank you.